Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome you to this service this morning. It's good to see you in this lovely sunny morning. And just as people are coming in, I'll want to read a few verses just from Psalm 95. Psalm 95, just the first two verses. And it says, "O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the Lord, to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise." We'll come this morning just to sing praise to God. And if you're a visitor here this morning, and I know we have a few visitors, you're very, very welcome. For those joining online, you're very welcome as well. The song we're going to sing to start with is "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." And the story goes that a friend of Charles Wesley said to him one day that if he had a thousand tongues, he would use every one of them to sing praise to God. So we might be having a thousand tongues here this morning, but we're going to stand to sing. We're going to stand to raise the roof, to praise God for his faithfulness to us, and just for the amazing God that he is. I've been asked to remind the men that as we sing this song, at the end of the verse, I'm not going to sing this bit, by the way, but do you know where it goes? "The triumphs of his grace." So the men will come in with that, and then the ladies will follow. You'll know whenever we get to that point what I'm talking about. Do you want me to sing it? No, you don't. Of course you don't. So we'll stand to sing, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." Thank you. Team. All I can say, men, is I'm glad Charles Wellesley's not here this morning. But we got there, I think, in the end. Let's just come to the Lord now in prayer as we bring our prayers and petitions to him as a church family. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we do indeed just take this time this morning to come together as a church, to come together as a church family, to acknowledge that you are sovereign God. We acknowledge that all creation came together and is held together by the power of your voice. We acknowledge as a church that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and above you there is no other. We acknowledge this morning that you are full of grace and truth and love, and all of which you have lavished upon us. Lord, we give you thanks for the grace that has set us free. We give you thanks for that day when you opened our eyes and our ears to your gospel message. And as Christians, Lord, may we never cease to be amazed at how you saved us, how you breathed new life in us, how you've taken us out of the mire of our sin and set us up on the rock of our salvation. We thank you, Lord, for your steadfast love that knows no bounds. Lord, we pray as Paul prayed for the early church, that we may understand how we are rooted and grounded in love, that we may grasp with all the church what is the breadth and length and height and depth of your love towards us. Lord, we just pray that if there's any here who don't know you as Lord and Savior, we pray that this morning that you might speak to them through your word. We pray that you might show them their need and their way to salvation through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Lord, we pray just that you forgive us for those times when we doubt you, for those times when we rely on our own wisdom, on our own strength, when we leave you out of our decision-making, when we go too long without reading your word, without calling out to you. I ask Jesus to forgive us, Lord, for not living for you as we ought, for doing those things that are contrary to your word. Pray, Lord, that you forgive us for not submitting to your word and for not walking in your will. Lord, as a church family, we thank you for the fellowship that we enjoy here. We pray for those who can't be with us this morning through illness or old age. We pray for that they know your presence this morning. We pray that they know your strength. We pray that in the days ahead that you will continue to lead and to strengthen them. We pray especially this morning for Pearl and for Gerald, for their bereavement of Pearl's brother Jim. Lord, just ask you that you are with them, that they know your peace this morning, Lord. They know your strength this morning. We just pray for the wider family circle, the same thing, Lord. And we pray for their granddaughter Emma. Who's in Scotland this week, who's just undergone surgery, Lord. We just ask you that she knows your healing hand. And we thank you for the faithful preaching of your word here week by week. And we pray for Alan and for Luke, that you continue to guide them, that you continue to speak to them through your word as they prepare Sunday by Sunday. And we pray for our elders and our deacons, just the same thing, that their quiet times are filled with a meeting of you, that you continue to build them up in their faith. And we pray for our country this morning, a country that was once called a land of saints and scholars, but's now cold to your word. Pray for those who stay away from your church this morning because they're cold to the gospel message. And we pray for revival. We pray for revival, not just in the streets and the towns, but in the pews of your church throughout this land. We pray that you revive your church, O Lord. Rather than praying for protection, we pray for a boldness to lovingly preach your gospel through our lives, through our actions, and if need be, through our words. But may we continue to look and live for you, and we may see a mighty harvest gathered in for you. We do all this for your honor and for your glory. It's in your precious, precious name I pray. Amen. Just ask George now to come up and bring our announcements for the week ahead.
First of all, I'd like to give you all a very warm welcome to our service. Good to see a good number gathered out this morning. And if you're tuning in online, we bid you warmly welcome to our service here today, and pray that we'll all know God's presence, whether in the building here or whether you're watching online. Announcements for the coming week are as follows. You'll remember that at the end of the first part of the service, we wait around the Lord's table. If you know and love the Saviour, could I encourage you please to stay and partake of the emblems. And if you just would like to stay and observe, that's fine if you would like to do that. And following this morning's service, it'll be followed by a soup lunch, fellowship lunch in the church hall. So you're welcome to that. Those who've their names down, I'm sure we could squeeze one or two more in. I'll maybe be in trouble for saying that. But anyway, well, if you're here and you'd like to join with us for fellowship, we'd love you to do that after the morning service. Then this evening service at 6, it's Thomas's farewell with us this evening. Thomas, is, if you don't know, has been with us for the past 7 months as a student from the Irish Baptist College, and his placement comes to an end with us today, so we're having a wee farewell for him tonight. We'll be nice to him this morning, and he'll maybe get a wee bit of abuse tonight before he leaves, but anyway, come along tonight, please, and have a time with us, a time of fellowship with us, as we say goodbye to Thomas and wish him well as he goes back to Cookstown, to his home church, and serve the Lord there. So please remember, 6 o'clock this evening. Tuesday at 11, it's our seniors meeting. If you fall into that category, you'll be very welcome to that. And I'm not going to define what a senior is, that's up to you. If you feel you're a senior, please do come along and join with us on Tuesday at 11. On Wednesday at 8, it's our prayer meeting and Bible study. And then on Friday night, there's a special night with GMSA, Gospel Mission to South America, a fellowship night in the church hall. So there's an invitation, an open invitation to you all to attend that. Service is next Sunday at the usual time of 11 and 6. And as you come in, you should have got a May program. We're now into the month of May, or will be in the next day or two. So please keep those programs handy, and that will let you know what's on throughout the month. And our thanks to Paula for preparing that, pulling all that information together for us. And then finally, the WEC prayer battery will be held tomorrow morning in Louis' home on the main street at 10:30, and Andrew and Jenny McCulloch will be along speaking at that meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Well, as George said, I'm a student assistant, and I've been here this last 7 months, and I've been taught a lot of things. One thing that I've been taught is to keep your mouth shut when you're standing up here and not say things as a joke. I kind of stress as a joke, but some people don't understand jokes. Some people, one man particular, and I haven't mentioned his name. Let's just call him Alan. First name that's come into mind, who doesn't understand jokes. So I have to do something now that I said a few months ago. If there's somebody here who doesn't know what I have to do now, I said that before, or my last Sunday, I would do the actions to the children's hymn. And yes, it's about to happen. One thing that Alan always said throughout the 7 months, that I should be ready for anything. So I've come prepared this morning. I brought a towel, because I'm sweating already. So I don't know what I'm going to be like after. I've got my water with me. What else have I in here? So you do know what this is then. This is great stuff if you pull a muscle or if you have a sports injury. So if you're going to use this, check with your doctor first of all. Don't be coming to me. It didn't work. So I'm going to have something that's maybe very, very important here. Is my blood pressure monitor. I'm not going to use that because I think it'll explode. But seriously, one thing, this is for the kids. I'm going to ask the boys and girls to come up and to give me a hand. And if you do, This is bribery. No, this is encouragement. This is encouragement for you to come up to the front and to help me do the actions. I've asked some of the praise team as well to come up to the front, so well. I said it before the service, whenever I ask you, you've all said that you'll do it, and whenever I ask you, you'll probably just sit there and look at me, which they're doing at the minute, so come on, get up. But boys and girls, good. I see some movement here. Come on, Ellen. Lovely. Now, you're not getting these sweets until after. I want to see actions out of you, first of all. Anybody else here? Yes, good stuff. Anybody else? Brilliant. Come on, that's it. That's fantastic. If you have wee kids, you know, your mums and dads can bring them up as well. No? Anybody? Listen, I have lots of sweets here. Lots and lots of sweets. So that's for the youngsters. Right. I think I've procrastinated enough. So what are we going to sing? All my life. All my... Is it? Sorry? No, I don't want to do Peace Like a River. Yes, yes, wherever I go, yes, I recognize that. Okay, right, away we go.
Thank you.
honestly. I'm up the lift, though. Right, we're going to pray for the Sunday School now, just before they go out. So we'll just quieten our hearts and just pray for the work of the Sunday School and for our young people. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we do indeed just thank you for our young people, for our boys and girls, for all the youth in the church here. And we thank you that we can have that wee bit of fun, just the simple way of doing the actions. But Lord, even through that, even through doing actions and singing for you, we're showing that joy that's in our heart. Not because we can do actions, not because we enjoy having a laugh, but because of the love that you have for us. And that joy that comes into our hearts through the love that you have for us. And we can see that in our young people. Lord, what a blessing that is, that we see them enjoying worshiping you, enjoying hearing about you. Lord, we just pray for them as they go into the Sunday School. We just thank you for our Sunday School and for our teachers. And Lord, we just pray that you continue to be with our young people today and next week into school and everything that comes their way, Lord, and all the influences that won't be good for them, Lord. We just pray that you bring them through, that they continue to look to you and that they serve you and they know you as Lord and Savior. Lord, just we thank you that we can leave that with you. Lord, we pray for Alan this morning as he is about to open up your word. Lord, pray for your Holy Spirit that just quietens our hearts, opens our hearts to your word. We hear you speaking to us, and we hear your word, that it's a word of transformation, Lord, of encouragement, and for everything that you need it to be, Lord. We just look to you now. We pray this in your precious, precious name. Amen. We're going to have our offering hymn now, and it's Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, a lovely hymn. So we'll remain seated as the offering's being lifted, and then at the right time, we'll stand to sing Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Thank you.
Turn with me, please, in God's Word, 2 Timothy chapter 4. We're going to be reading from verse 9. Good to see you all here this morning. And indeed, I have to say, I'm highly impressed with Thomas, a man of his word. And you didn't say, actually, there's a defibrillator out there as well. Out in the back kitchen, so there, the old kitchen. So we were well covered in every way, but indeed, we thank you for, we'll be saying more tonight, but we appreciate your partnership, really, with us here in the gospel, and indeed for your willingness. I was going to say get your sleeves rolled up, but he literally do that, like somebody else in the church, but we'll not say anything more, but we have had a tremendous 7 months, but we'll say more about that this evening. Good to have Dawn here this morning as well, and also their daughter Erin, and wee Zach, that was him going for the offering plate, so it was. So I don't know whether it's his dad or mum, but Mark here as well. Good to have, he's here, Erin's away out with Zach to the creche, but do pray for them as a family. Pray for their daughter-in-law, Rebecca. She's in hospital. Last week we were congratulating them on the birth of little Bobby, their third grandson. And but during the week, Rebecca, she contracted E. coli and is in hospital. And they've taken Bobby in as well. So I think they're separated by two floors, and their son Elliot is there with them. So do remember them in prayer as well at this difficult time, and indeed that the Lord's touch will be upon them all. Turning, say, to 2 Timothy chapter 4, we are near the end, and God willing, next week we will finish this book. Actually, there's one other announcement I want to say as well. Good to have David Gordon here this morning. And David, we'd again express sympathy to David and to the family on the passing of David's uncle, Davy. Willie Boone, known so well to us, went to be with the Lord just over January, I think it was, or December, a year ago. And then Willie's brother passed away during the week, and the funeral was here on Friday, and David was responsible for that. He's here from Scotland. He drops in from time to time, so good to have him here this morning, and we want to assure you of continued prayers, and indeed we express our sympathy to you all as a family at this time as well. So 2 Timothy chapter 4, we're picking it up again, because really we are in a message, and it's been a number of weeks since I've been able to look at this, but we're in the last section, and really what we're doing with this section is just breaking it up. There's a lot of material, although it's very practical, as you'll see this morning. And in some sense, I hoped I could have been able to finish it all off this morning. But next week, you'll see, God willing, as to why I'm leaving the verses that we'll be looking at next week to next week. Because really, they are very precious verses and will be a help and encouragement. But this morning as well, a help, encouragement, challenge. Paul says in verse 9, "Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me." Of course, Paul speaking to Timothy. Timothy is in Ephesus, and we know that Paul is in prison under house arrest for his faith in the Lord, and he wants Timothy to come to him. He says, "For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, is departed unto Thessalonica. Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia, only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. And Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when thou comest, bring with thee. And the books, but especially the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works, of whom be thou ware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words." We'll end there, say, at the end of verse 15, leaving really the rest of it until next week, God willing. But really, as we're looking at this, I've simply entitled the this series of messages, Helpers and Harmers. And it reminds us that the church is not perfect. The church looks to the perfect Savior. But we in the church, while we, many of us, those of us who are saved, we rejoice that we have that perfect standing before the Lord Jesus Christ because of what he did for us on the cross of Calvary, that yet practically we still sin each day. And that's something that we need to pray about each day. It's something we need to keep short accounts with God. Whenever we do sin, I certainly believe we don't lose our salvation, because we're not depending on our works. We're depending on the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Maybe you're here this morning and you're not saved for the very fact that you're saying, well, if I got saved, I would let the Lord down. Well, you would be joining the club, as it were. Because, as I say, we all sin each day. Maybe you'd be thinking, well, if I get saved and I sin against God, does that mean then that I'm going to lose my salvation? Well, from what we are taught in the Word of God, we firmly believe that you will not lose your salvation. And I know there are many people, and I say this because I know there are many people in the world today, and that's what they're listening to from the devil. They know they need to be saved. Perhaps today you're somebody and you know that you need to be saved. Why do you need to be saved? Well, you need to be saved so that you're going to be in heaven for all of eternity and not hell. And that's the clear teaching of the Bible, the clear teaching of the Word of God. That's the clear teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That indeed that there's a heaven to be gained, there's a hell to be shunned. We're all born in sin, and we all have a sin nature. And that sin will take us out into hell and into eternal torments. It'll take you out into hell and into eternal torments if you never trust the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. And that's why then we preach Jesus Christ crucified. That he died upon the cross, that he died for the punishment for sins. He died so that we could be saved, so that by trusting in him, that we could then be sure that we're going to be in heaven for all of eternity. And our prayer today is, if you're somebody here and you're not saved, that you understand today that you're on the broad road that is taking you out into a lost eternity in hell, but that there is a Savior today. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. And he's the Savior because of what he did upon the cross. He was nailed to the cross. And there upon that cross, what has it happened? Darkness descended over all of the land. Because God the Father then poured down on his Son there upon the cross the very punishment that every single one of us deserve for our sins. But in taking the punishment, dying upon the cross, what is it he did? He opened the life gate that all may go in. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And today, many of us gathered here, we rejoice that we're saved, that we're assured of a home in heaven, not because of our good works, not because we ever thought that we're better than other people. The reason we got saved was because we realized that we're a sinner and that we're deserving of hell. But we realized that there's a Savior who died upon the cross for us, and therefore we called upon him for salvation. And how wonderful is that, was that day whenever we passed, as it were, from death unto life, from darkness, from spiritual darkness into his marvelous light, and we entered into the family of God, and we're saved today because of what Jesus Christ did for us, not because of anything that we have done. For we cannot, we could never save ourselves. It's not by works. So many people today are depending on good works. And for many people, you know what one of those good works is? It's attending church. But attending church will never take anybody to heaven. It'll never take anybody to heaven. You can have your name in any church roll. You can have your name in many church rolls, but there's only one roll that matters, only one book that matters, and that is the book of life, the Lamb's book of life. And those who trust in Jesus Christ for salvation, their names are written in the Lamb's book of life, and therefore they are the people that will be in heaven for all of eternity. And today our prayer is that if you're not saved, that you will come and put your trust in the Savior. Why? Because today he still invites you to come. He still invites you to come. This is still the day of opportunity, but we're warned in the Word of God, behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Proverbs 27, verse 1 says, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. Not one of us is guaranteed we'll even put our head on the pillow tonight. And therefore, there's an urgency to salvation. There's an urgency to getting saved, getting right with God, and ensuring that you're going to be in heaven forever. Will you not come today and put your trust in Him? To say what we depend on, therefore, is the finished work of Jesus Christ. That our standing today as God looks upon us, what he sees is the perfectness, the perfection of Jesus Christ, the righteousness of Jesus Christ, which has been put on our account. And that's what will ensure that we go to heaven. But yet we know that as we live in this world, as we live in the church, that, well, we're not perfect practically. We still sin against God. We still can do. We still do wrong things, and the sad reality is that we can still do it within the church, and we need to be so careful about our lives. And that's why I've entitled these messages from verse 9 down to verse 22, harmers and helpers, or helpers and harmers. And I trust today that as we look at these names and as we look at these people that Paul refers to, that what we can say today is that when it comes to the church of Jesus Christ, that we are a helper to the work of the gospel, and we're not somebody who stands in harm's way and indeed brings disrepute to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we have looked at this, we have looked at a number of people. We saw, first of all, say the desire of Paul. We saw that in verse 9, verse 21, Paul wanted Timothy to come to him. Timothy was a blessing to Paul. He was Paul's son in the faith. And we looked at that. Then we looked at the desertion of Paul. That was Demas. Why did Demas leave Paul? Verse 10, because he loved this present world. And that's a challenge to all of us who are Christians. Because Satan is still doing everything he can to draw us back into the ways of the world. And we need to be so careful. And that's why we need to pray to God for his help, for the Holy Spirit who lives within us to help us to turn from temptation and indeed to live lives that are pleasing unto God. And then we looked at the dispatch from Paul. Paul sent a number of people out. Cretans went to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia, and Tychicus, he was being sent down to Ephesus so that Timothy could come to Paul. Paul's heart, here he was at the end of his life. What was Paul's heart? That the gospel spread. The gospel spread into other places, into new places. And that's something that is a tremendous challenge to us, that is, and particularly those who near the end of life, that you still have that heart for seeing the gospel go forth, and particularly for missionary work. That the Lord will bless it and build his church. And then we saw the delight of Paul, and that's where we looked at the last time. Verse 11, he says, take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Do you know something? One time they had a fallout. We know that Mark was on the first missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas, and Mark, he jumped ship, as it were. He deserted them, and Paul struggled with that. And whenever it came to wanting to go on a second missionary journey, Barnabas wanted to take John Mark. Paul didn't want him anywhere near the place. And we know that that they went separate ways after a strong dispute. And yet what we see is at the end of his life, John Mark was somebody that Paul wanted there. Why? Because they had made up. They had sorted things out. And John Mark was a great blessing to him. So that really is just recapping, and we move on today. As I look, first of all, here this morning at the demand of Paul. And to say, these are practical verses, and yet they can be a tremendous help to us, because I'm sure today, or I trust today, that the heart of us all is that we want to do what we can to help the furtherance of the gospel, to help those who are in the Lord's work, to help missionaries and all, and to help people, to say, who have given a life of service to the Lord, and people who maybe have never gone to the mission field, but maybe it's been within the life of the local church, that there they have given a life of service to the Lord. How important that as they approach the end of life, that we do not forget them, that we seek to be an encouragement to them, that even though they may not, and there'll be some who'll be listening to the CDs of this, and this is speaking about them, that they know that they're not forgotten, that their labors for the Lord is so much appreciated still, and that we do what we can perhaps as well to help them even as they come to the end of life. To say what we see here, and really this is focusing on these practical words of verse 13. Timothy was to bring Mark with him when he was going to see Paul in Rome. But what we see is that wasn't all that Paul wanted, because what he wanted was a few items that he mentions here. Look at verse 13. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when thou comest, bring with thee, and the books, but especially the parchments. Now, winter was coming, and it seems that Paul was thinking of himself, and thinking to himself that if he was to get through it physically there in that prison, he needed his cloak to keep him warm. He was in what was known as the Marmatime prison, and you need to remember back in those days, prison was so different. There was no oil heating, there was no electric heating, there was nothing like that at all. And it would have been a very cold place in the winter time, and there would have been guards who didn't care about the prisoners' comforts. And really, it would have been a case of each man for himself. And thinking of this, Paul said, remember, he was an older man. And what I've seen in quite a number of, and George was afraid there earlier to define who's old people and who's not when he was announcing the seniors meeting on Tuesday. But what I've seen in quite a number of older people that I've met down through the years is that they like their heat. They like the heat, so they do. I'm trying not to look at anybody here. Some of their homes, you could grow tomatoes in. So you could. Some other boys might think we could grow some other things, but we'll not mention that. But some of them you could grow tomatoes in all the year round because they're so warm. And some of them are like saunas, and yet they still think it's cold. Some of them I've been visiting in, and the sweat's been pouring. I don't know what Thomas's towel. The sweat's been pouring off me, and they think, well, we could do with another log or two in the fire. And that's July time. So it is. If Paul was like this as he was getting older, his cloak would have been, certainly it wouldn't have been the answer, but it certainly would have been a tremendous help to him. But what we see here is that this wasn't all that Paul wanted, because at the end of the verse, he said this, he says, and bring the books, but especially the parchments. Now, biblical scholars, biblical commentators, not really 100% sure what exactly this meant. Some think the books that Paul wanted were the Old Testament books that he possessed, but to say they're not definite about it. And really, as for the parchments, some think that maybe they were copies of letters that Paul had written but had not sent. And yet others think that maybe the parchments that he's talking about here were actually blank. And therefore, what he wanted to do in the prison was that he could write more letters to different people and to different churches. And really, we asked the question this morning, well, what do we learn from this? So it's a very practical verse. Probably a verse that maybe many of us, we've looked at, maybe we've read it, we've thought, or maybe we haven't thought anything about it. But yet I think that there's practical lessons for us to learn in this, because I believe that to Paul, it was significant, because even though he was in prison and even though he was near the end of the life, he still wanted to make his time there profitable, however long or short it was. I think there's a number of lessons that we can learn from this morning. Say, he obviously wanted to be comfortable with the cloak being brought to him, and we can't blame him for that. But reading and further writing were something that we understand that he still longed to do. And really, there's two lessons I conclude from this morning. The first lesson is this, is that being out of circulation, it doesn't mean it's the end of what you can do for the Lord. Maybe you're somebody and you're thinking to yourself, I'm getting there. Say, maybe you're somebody watching it online today. Maybe you're somebody who will hear it on the CD. But maybe some of us could be in this position this time next week. An injury or illness, it strikes us down and we're not able to be out and about, and we're not able to meet with the people of God. But what an important lesson it is to us, that being out of circulation due to circumstances beyond our control, it doesn't mean it's the end of what we can do for the Lord. Reading and writing is great for the mind, and it's great for the stimulation of it. I know some folks not able to come to church, and that's what they do. They're still able to read and write, and they write letters, they write cards, and they can be they're still an encouragement to people that they cannot go and see anymore. I was thinking about this. I was reminded of a number of people of old, and people whose work, whenever they've been out of circulation, is still having an impact in the present day. And one of those people is a lady by the name of Fanny Crosby. She was born March 24th, 1820, and she endured her first hardship as a six-week-old baby when a visiting physician mistreated, they say, an eye infection. Although the family believed that his attempts to treat the infection actually resulted in total blindness. Although some modern experts contend that she may have been born with congenital blindness. However, she learned, even though she was blind, even though she was not able to be out and about like all the other boys and girls, young people and adults, she still learned to sing and play the organ. She also learned to play the harp, the guitar, and the piano. And William Bradbury, a publisher and hymn writer, it said that he changed Fanny Crosby's life because they were introduced on February the 2nd, 1854. And here's what she said, and you see it on the screen. She says, "Fan, I feel 100 hymns in my head. The Lord has given me a purpose in my life." Isn't that remarkable? Because incredibly, Fanny sometimes composed 6 or 7 hymns a day. And she was able to memorize maybe up to 12 before she then dictated them to her secretary. And what we know is that at the end of her life, remember she was blind from 6 weeks old, she penned over 8,000 hymns. I think also of a man by the name of John Bunyan. John Bunyan put in prison for his faith, but what is it that we still have in the day, and many people still read it, as regarded as one of the classic writings of literature, even acknowledged by unsaved people, Pilgrim's Progress. And there he was, and he was in prison, he was out of the way, but did he sit there and mope? No, what he did was he got to work and he wrote Pilgrim's Progress. And as I say, it's a classic in this very day. And to say there's so many others that we could have mentioned, and there's so many different ways, and maybe today, to say there are those, say, who'll be watching online listening. They're not able to be out, but how can they be used? They can be used in different ways. Another great way is what? Is prayer. What's the one regret, or the one thing that many of us who are saved, who are busy in life and just always on the go, what's the one thing we, most of us, if not all of us, would love to be able to do more of in our lives? We'd love to pray, wouldn't we? Pray more. Spend more time with God in prayer. But maybe today you're somebody and say you're not able to be out and about as much. You ever think of using the time more so in prayer? Christian service is not about about being up at the front. The Christian service that I believe God will honor will be a service that is done by many people on the quiet and out of the way that nobody else sees. And prayer is what? Prayer is getting alone with God. Spending those hours with Him in prayer, praying for the work of the church, praying for the people of the church, praying for the work of the gospel, the advancement of the gospel in the world, praying for those in authority over us, praying for all the needs of our land, praying indeed, say, for the sick, praying for, say, just the list is endless. And perhaps you're somebody today and maybe you're in those advanced years or you find yourself in a situation, you have more time to yourself and you're thinking to yourself, what could I do? What could I do that it'll be profitable? Well, pray. Spend time in prayer with God. As I say, many of us, we say we're busy with work, we're busy with all the commitments that we have in life. And I would say we all would say, I wish I had more time to pray. Well, if you're somebody today and you have that time, take it and use it, and indeed use it for the glory of honor and honor of His name. So we have, say, if we look at the demand of Paul, let's say what he wanted the cloak, he wanted the parchments, and he was going to use, by all accounts, the time well. So we see, first of all, say, being out of circulation, it doesn't mean it's the end of what you can do for the Lord. And secondly, I want you to note that practically, this is something for those of us who, say, are busy in life and on the go all the time. Practically help those who are out of circulation by delivering to them what they want, what they need to help them. Isn't that what Paul wanted Timothy to do? He wanted Timothy to, maybe it was a journey that maybe was going to add a few extra miles, because it says in verse 13, the cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when thou comest, bring with thee in the books, and, but especially the parchments. I didn't check it out great geographically, where Ephesus was, where Rome was, where was Troas. But it may have meant that for Timothy, that maybe it was going to add a little bit onto his journey. That maybe it was going to add an extra day or two onto his journey. And yet what we see is that Paul was asking him that he would do this, as it were, go the extra mile, go that little bit extra. So that whenever he got to Paul, that he would be a tremendous blessing. And as they say, I think that challenge is a challenge to all of us, and say, I know that there are many today, and you'll say, well, Alan, I want to do something for the Lord, but I can't teach, I can't preach, I can't play a musical instrument. I would drop dead if you asked me to share my testimony or do anything like that. I couldn't do anything even to maybe just a short word at the Lord's table. But how important that we realize that there's a whole lot more can be done for the Lord. And a whole lot more that all of us, I believe, can be doing for the Lord. It's not all upfront roles for all. As I say, that's what sometimes we think, and sometimes we get discouraged. You see, I think sometimes we need to remember as well, and I love it when people share that they want to do more for the Lord, but they're maybe discouraged because they say, well, I can't be like the pastor, I can't be like the elders, or I can't be like the department leaders or others who are involved in the work. And but yet what we need to see is that's not what God has called us all to. Because when you read 1 Corinthians chapter 12, what you read there is that there's the body, and the body has many different parts. And the body needs the eyes, it needs the ears, it needs the nose, it needs the heart, it needs, say, all the different parts. And we know that if many of those parts, once you remove it, that, well, all of the body is affected. Some parts that maybe we think of, or maybe we don't think of because we wonder to ourselves, or we don't know how vital they are. And yet, whenever people go for surgery and maybe a certain part is removed, maybe a part that we don't hear about too much, it still affects the rest of the body. And you see, there are people that are needed to be up front. But there are people that are needed there in the background, working away, doing all those things that maybe never even acknowledged. Maybe one of those things that we could be doing is maybe looking out for those in our congregation, those in our church, those in our community who can't get to church, but they would love somebody just to help them practically. Might be to cut a bit of grass. Might be to hoover the house. Clean their windows. It might be just to come in, just to make a cup of tea or coffee for them and sit with them for half an hour. Just pray with them before we leave. So I say so many different ways. See, Paul here, whenever you look at this, really we would say, like, Paul wasn't asking for much. Cloak, parchments, books. Maybe books with nothing in them. If Thomas emptied out his bag the other day and set it all out, well, some of the stuff he'd have been better keeping in the bag, but anyway. If Thomas was to have lifted out his coat and set it there, and if he was to lift out his and maybe a few books from his study, we might all look at it and think, well, there's not much there really. It's only a coat. I don't think he wears an expensive one. He's a Bible college student after all, so. But we would say, well, there's not a lot there. But if he was to turn around and say, hey, these aren't mine, these belong to somebody in another country, would there be anybody going there who could take them? They might think to ourselves, well, I could maybe fit it into my luggage. But yet what I've seen is, and I've seen it with missionaries, if you're on Facebook with missionaries, whenever they receive stuff from home, it's amazing the blessing. I'm always amazed how they put photos on Facebook of, it's usually food from home, potato, cheese and onion crisps, something like that. That's what I would want if ever I was away on a long term. But they put it on, and the joy that it just brings to them, maybe a bar of chocolate from home, you know, things that we have here. You can take us out of Northern Ireland, but you can't take Northern Ireland out of us. Those little things bring big blessing. And it's the same as well, I believe, of people who are not able to get to church every week. That we would be practically minded, that we would look to help them, because Paul, say, we look at it and we think a coat and books, not a lot. But yet it was vital to him. Or that we would be looking for the opportunities. I'm not going to go to the rest of the text. Time is gone. Soup, I don't want to be blamed for it being burnt. So I don't. So I'm going to leave it there. And I'll try and condense everything into next week. But may, to say, even just as we look at this practical thing, this practical verse, we think practically. Because what I've learned as a pastor in church life is this. You see, the people that are the greatest blessings in church life, they're not always people who can stand in a pulpit and preach great theology. They're people whose theology is based on Christ and his example of helping others. Helping others with their needs, helping them simply, doing what they could practically to help them. That is what I've seen over the years as a pastor. That is what bonds a church together. That is what gives fellowship deeper meaning. And that is what really helps and holds people up whenever they're going through their trying and difficult times. We might, yes, we need the theology, but we need to take then the practical side of it. And so often we hear about the negative sides of churches. They don't care. They don't seem to love each other. They don't look out for each other. Well, even just a coat and books was going to bring great blessing to a man who was out of circulation. As I say, it's practical things that can give a church a great testimony. And I know many of you do it because our church has a tremendous testimony, I believe, for that. May we be encouraged by it. Keep pressing on and keep doing the work for the glory of God. I'm going to sing our closing hymn. There is a hope that burns within my heart, that gives me strength for every pressing day. A glimpse of glory now revealed in meager part, yet drives all doubt away. We'll stand to sing this as our closing hymn at this part of the service. Thank you. Father, we just pray your blessing upon your word. We pray for the unsaved here today that this will be the day of their salvation. That, Father, they'll come and put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We know Satan wants them to compare themselves to everybody else in the church, have them thinking that they're as good as anybody else. But, Lord, we pray today that they would see that it's only by having the perfect righteousness of Christ in their lives that they can be saved, that that is the standard, and that they'll never meet it, but they need the Savior for it. So, Father, we pray that today will be the day of their salvation. For those of us who are saved, we've been thinking practically here today. Father, help us, Lord, to care for one another, to love one another, to edify, that is, build up one another. And, Lord, we can do this by helping each other, even in simple, practical ways. Remember those not able to be with us. Lord, those who are advanced in years, those who are unable to come to church, Lord, because of ill health, may they know they're not forgotten about, and that we'll do what we can to help them in whatever ways we can. So, Father, bless those who will leave us now, your hand of blessing upon them. For those of us who remain here at the Lord's table, bless our time of fellowship as we remember him, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.